Daktari ga bone QHSC.
Another thing that I really liked during the mission was spending time with the kids. We did a lot with the kids. It made my heart really happy to see all those smiling faces when we gave out all of the donations and everything. And yeah, the floor is yours, Sandy.
Same thing here. When you had mentioned you went in with no expectations and going into a different country from the United States, of course, how I want to say kind of spoiled we are here. I had the good fortune of, I traveled to Costa Rica quite a bit. So I got to experience missing things or our luxury comforts. So going with this gang, I had mentioned before I went in as an individual, I did meet Karank and Dr. Gabone. Briefly, it was a Friday the 13th, if you believe in all that good luck stuff. So I wasn't quite sure. I don't have nursing. I've been in administration all my life. And I feel as far as like human connections, I always try to have a nice time or be a support system for people, whether it's the people that are actually the mission team or the people in the country. As I said to Perron before, I felt like I went in and they gave me, I came home with way more than I felt like I gave them because I never felt sad. I never felt like I felt sorry for them. They were joyful. They were singing. They were laughing. They were dancing. And I got to spend a lot of the first week at the school. So we were with those kids and it was just a wild ride and they were happy and they were playing. And I was fortunate enough to help with Dr. Vanessa, who did the eye screenings, the vision screenings. So basically, I got to see individually almost every child that was there and just watching them and seeing the different personalities as little individuals and then as a group when they were running around and standing in line for their lunch or we'd sit out and just sit on the step and just watch them run around and they were just as fascinated with us as we were with them. And Dr. Gabone, the last day we were there, I was just a mess. I was like, I was crying. I was like, I don't want to leave them. It was just such a, just a joyful, fun environment. And then after my first week there, the second week, I did ask if I could go to the hospital because the group that I met, the mission workers, Yessie and Bree and Hunter, and Marcella, and I called the sisters, and then we had sports girls. I called everybody sort of nicknames. We would sit at dinner and we would trade stories about our days. And I was like, I really like to go to the hospital. And I got to see newborn babies and I got to go with a small group and we were giving the moms blankets and hats and things. And I got to bundle up a baby and be silly and hold a baby. And it was just, I got a very well-rounded experience because I was put in as administration with the school, but then I was blessed enough to request going to the hospital and I got to spend a few days there and watch a few of the nursing student girls give presentations on the keeping the babies warm and postpartum. And Bree Vargas gave a presentation. I was very impressed by these young students on the mission team. So I got to cover a lot of bases. It was just amazing. The conversation with the group at the end of the day was amazing. We were all tired, exchanging information, exchanging just how great the day was. And we were exhausted. And that was like the best reward is like, you know, you've put a lot of energy, mind and body into something when you just pooped out at the end of the day.
Agreed.
That's one of the things that I remember. And I think that you kind of have that, I guess that's a common point there because Valentine was big. I had never heard of this thermal regulation and all this stuff like that. I mean, I've seen babies in hospitals. I know that they kind of wrap them up and they give them the hats and all that stuff, but I didn't understand what went behind it. But that's one of the things that that Valentine was very, very big on. And I think that's the why she interacted so much with so many children. She spent a lot of time, actually days, doing thermal regulation and consulting or advising mothers and stuff like that. So.
Yeah. So we basically gave out the hats, onesies, socks, blankets, all that good stuff to help keep a baby warm. And then we taught the mothers when we gave them, we gathered all the items together. And so when we would go to each mother and give them the gift, we would teach them how to properly, you know, keep their baby warm. And we even taught them how to swaddle the way we do here in the States. so that was really neat. And so let me just give you a little back end with thermal regulation. So in my culture, we believe that, you know, they always say you're supposed to, there's a saying, it goes, chauffe petitla, meaning you have to heat up the baby. Not technically. But with my first child, I didn't believe that. I thought, you know, you can hurt a baby by making them too hot. So then I got into nursing and I learned why it's so important. Something as simple as like, okay, so when a baby is not kept warm, they lose energy. So that can lead to like other complications. And so I learned how important it is to, you know, regulate their temperatures. And that's why I went all in that area. I loved it. I love it still. So.
Yeah, that was fun. That was a good experience. Those 2 days I got to go and observe that. I was just an observer. I was watching the nursing student explain to the moms, and Dr. Gaboni was there translating. And then I got to, like I said, I got to swaddle a baby. I said, do they know what a burrito is here? It's like, make that baby a burrito. But it's, you know, I said, like you said, when you were younger, my mom was not college educated, but she was always like, keep a hat on that baby. Put a hat on that baby. And it's scientifically, your nursing school teaches you stuff like that. It's like, oh, now I know why my mother said that. Mm-hmm. It makes sense. Keeping that baby warm.
Yes.
And in Africa where it's hot, it's like, wow, I feel hot. But some of the kids were wearing sweaters. I guess their hot versus our hot was different, as I noticed in Iringa where it was freezing.
Well, I'm gonna pull up a picture, Sandy, and then I'm gonna ask you to see if you could explain to us what was going on at that moment. I also have a video too, so the picture, remember, there's not going to be as much movement or anything like that. So let me see if I can share my screen. Hold on a second. Can you see the picture?
I was writing down the, oh my gosh, that was one of the little bitty kids with those maroon shirts on. Are we sure that wasn't Prince? He followed us everywhere. There was one little boy, he turned up, I swore he was a triplet. I thought he'd come home. Seriously, everybody loved Prince. I was writing on the card probably after I screened him with the little eye chart. I was always asking them, I would say their name. Like they would write it and I'd try to say their whole name and they would look at me. I was like, is that your name? And then they would repeat it for me. And of course, 9 times out of 10, I didn't pronounce it correctly, but I would say, I'm Sandy. And they were just, took them a few seconds to warm up with me. But at the end, they were like, you know, I was like, thank you, Masani. And they're like, big old cheesy grin. I was like, oh my gosh, they're so cute. They were just, that was a fun thing. I felt like I was with that vision screening, it was cool. I kind of felt like I was doing something, and then we were getting the kids through there, and Dr. Vanessa was very intent on making sure that we saw every single child. She was amazing. So that's what I was doing. I was probably asking the little boy his name or trying to pronounce it. But then I discovered a lot of the names were very repetitive. And I guess like here, Smith, Jones kind of thing. So, but yeah, those little ones in those the maroon outfits were just, oh my gosh.
Yeah, and I think I remember that the young boy that you were talking about, we called him, or I labeled him, the mayor. Because I remember one time I went to his classroom. You know, I didn't know that was his class. I just went there. And he just got up and walked out. You know, and I was like, yeah, that's why he just roams. So when we're getting on the bus, we're leaving to get on the bus, he walks to the bus and he says goodbye to everybody, shakes everybody's hand. So that's why I was like, he's the mayor. He's just like everywhere. So
he was. One day when we were going back to pick the crew up from the school, I saw him like in the little town, and I saw him through the window. I'm like, there's Prince, and I waved. So we got to the school and we went in, and then there he is. I'm like, he followed the bus back to the school and he came in, and we're like, does he have a sister? And there was a little girl that looked just like him, was his sister. And since everyone had their hair cut short, they looked very similar, but she had a skirt on. I mean, they may have been twins, but he was just always in the middle of conversation or holding somebody's hand or coloring, or, I mean, he was just like the prince. And one day, I think they said he was actually on the bus when we were going to load. I was like, he's going to wind up coming home with somebody.
No, nobody's going to notice. And next thing you know, you get to the hotel and he's there. We missed the head count.
Right. And he was little. He was in a little duffel bag. He was so cute. He was funny. He was a highlight. Definitely.
Nice. I think... One interesting thing about the mission trip as well is that we go there and we come out like learning a lot. We go in thinking we're just going to, you know, going to donate and give our time to teach or whatnot. And then you come out learning a lot.
It like I said to someone, I came back and I talked about it and I was like crying. I was like, I got filled up in places in my soul that I didn't know were empty. Because I didn't know what to expect when going to see these children or what they lacked, or they were getting educated. They were being, the last day, the dancing, the joy, they wanted to give us things. They wanted to give us things. And I'm like, oh my word, they're so, and I did. One child gave me a necklace. Another one gave me a picture. We had our QHSC pins. All those kids wanted a pin. If you had one on your hat, they were like, Miss Sandy, pin. I'm like, I give you a pin. I don't have 800 more. But there were a couple of the children that had, their English was excellent. So you kind of latch onto them. And then if you were in a little group speaking with the children, I'm like, Victor, what did they say? Are they making me say bad words? Because I would repeat some of the stuff they said. And he's like, oh, no, Miss Sandy. And they don't laugh at me. I'm like, I can't even imagine what I'm saying. I need, you know, somebody. But they were just so fun to hang out with. They were just, the first few days you could see they sort of stood back from us. But then when they saw we just were involved and just embracing them, they embraced us right back. And it was, when we walked in a few of those mornings, it was like, we walked past the classrooms and it would just explode. Like, there they are, yay, and just. The teachers were wonderful. They kept those kids in check. And they would, you'd walk past the classroom, you'd see some of the classrooms, the kids were just sitting there, and then other classrooms, the kids were just like, ah! And I'm like, oh, it's somebody, they're happy to see us. And it was genuine. It was, like I said, I walked away far more than what we could have ever given them, like monetarily or just to see how happy and joyful they are and smiling and singing and dancing. And they're walking around in the little courtyard holding hands with their friends. And they were just so sweet. They were just the essence of humanity. They were amazing. I'm going to cry.
Wow.
It was fun. It was a good time.
Yeah.
Yeah. And just to give you a little background, Valentine, So we actually did two schools the year before. I think one of them had 1,500 or 1,400 kids, so you could imagine. But so with this mission, Valentine, we literally spent almost, well, practically 2 weeks every day at the school doing sports and vision and, you know, different things with the kids and stuff. And then on that last day, if you want to describe, Sandy, exactly what happened, like you said, they wanted to give back to us, so.
We went in, that was the day after I was a little wimpy. We went in, was it Thursday? And they came marching out with their drums and cymbals, and evidently the rice bags that they had the rice in that was for lunches, they made into skirts and hats, because I'm like, where'd they get those costumes? And Harriet, Dr. Gabone said, oh, they made it out of the rice bags. And I was just like, oh my gosh, that is so creative. And they were dancing and singing, and the one little boys that were doing their best, I guess it was breakdancing type stuff. And they loved, they get up there and dance, and then they made us dance, woohoo. But they, oh my gosh, they just were all very organized and surrounding the courtyard. And they just, they, you could see it was like a class assembly. It was just an assembly where they were entertaining us and, you know, thanking us and greeting, you know, bidding us farewell. And it was emotional. I was like, oh my gosh, I'm going to miss not coming over here with these kids. And I'm not a big, like, I love my son, don't get me wrong, but I love these kids, because they were just joyful. They weren't like greedy little, I don't know, I can't describe them. They were just so fun to be around. They were so, the childhood, the untainted childhood, and they didn't care about anything except being happy and having friends and learning, and they were learning, and they had the arts and crafts with the sisters, and Yessie, who played with the, oh my gosh, I think Yessie, they had her as one of the children too. She was about as tall as them, and Yessie was a ball of energy. But yeah, they just, oh my gosh, it was like, how did I fall in love with something so quickly? And then it's like, I need to go back. And I said, somebody asked me, this, going back? I said, definitely. I said, they can take me now. I'll go now.
Yes, and they cooked for us too. They had we had like a nice little feast there at the school. They had a DJ. The school dance troupe did a dance, and then like you said, there was a few little groups that did their pop music, break dancing, electric boogie, freestyle, whatever you want to call it. A little bit of everything, and then they actually gave everybody gifts, which was kind of similar to what we did at the Magnet. Remember that time, Valentine, when we were at the Magnet?
And yeah,
everything going.
Mm-hmm. It was like a big party. Everybody was dancing, and they gave us the shirts.
Yep.
At that night, we went to the Magnet school. I went one night. The soccer, I forget what they.
It's a soccer.
We went, right, the soccer school, and we were sitting there, and they were real quiet, attentive, but the end, when we were, like, got up, and they had the music, and we were, like, they busted out of their shell, and it was, like, party in the classroom. So they do their serious stuff, but they like to do their celebrating, and that was just fun to watch.
So they didn't do this year with the Magnet like they did the year before. Actually, yeah, they even celebrated a child's birthday. They had a DJ, they celebrated a child's birthday, everybody started dancing, they had gifts for all the volunteers. That was the year before, so it was funny because I guess the school took over that.
I ate so much food while I was there, oh my gosh. And when we gave them, or they got in line for their lunches, which was usually, I guess, rice and beans and cabbage, they were always trying to feed us. And we had lunch brought in, but those kids were always trying to feed us or give us something. And they had little, I guess outside of the gate of the school, they had little vendors and stuff. And some of the kids would come in with little bags of fruit and kind of a freeze pop. And they were always trying to get, and I'm like, these children are amazing. Here we are, these, you know, I wonder what we represented to them. It's like, okay, here's the Americanis bringing us, you know, little backpacks and treats, but they wanted to give back. They wanted to give back, that generous spirit. They wanted to give back to us.
Yes. And I'm like, oh. And that was, yeah, that was one of the points that we made, because some of the volunteers were like, no, 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 we can't let them do that. We can't have them do that. You know, and then we were like, no, because, you know, we've come here, we've given, and they want to give back. They also have their expression or their way of, they want to show us, you know, how they appreciate us and, you know, what they want us to enjoy about that school that maybe we had not seen yet. So it was a perfect ending.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. I tried to be in every moment, and then I walk away and I'd like reflect back on it. And I'm like, oh my gosh, like, I wish I could remember everybody's name, that the teachers, and I was just overwhelmed. And the few children that stuck out like Prince, you could not know him, but you know, even our driver was D-River. I was like, yes, what yes. was his name? And then our servers, our hosts in the hostel, when we had our meals there, they were wonderful to us. I didn't go expecting any kind of treatment. I was like, I'm here to work. I'm here to serve right.
And that's the point of admission.
We were treated so well by everybody. I mean, we were tired at the end of the day, but we were just treated so well. And I got to give kudos to Dr. Gaboni and Pronk. I mean, the leadership, they always made everything okay for us. And, you know, we're tired. I know how I am. I get tired and cranky, and a good night of sleep does me really good. But they just always had us, our spirits, always. And then Steve, our prayer warrior, he always had our spiritual uplifting. And then our trip at the end, we had the trip at the end, we were fortunate enough to go to a wedding, and it was a road trip, and so we got to do some extra bonding with some really cool people. Nice. It was fun, so, but yeah, I just talk, and people ask me, I went back to work, and people were asking me, but I was like, I can't even put a finger on the best part of the trip. I get filled up, and then I was like, I just want to cry. It was so amazing. I wish I could pour my brain out and just wish that everybody would feel and get an experience like that, because not only did I want to go in and just give my time and my energy, I wanted to not be that whiny American that it's like, we have stuff and we're not happy. These kids have basically, you know, food and clothes, and they're happy as can be.
Exactly. Like,
we're so much to learn from them. So much to learn from them. So.
Well, I have one more video that I want to show you. This one might be a little more.
I know it's the dancing one.
No. let me see if I can share it on the screen here. Hold on. Here it is right here.
Hey. Okay.
Okay. All right, there it is. Hold on. Can you see it?
Yeah.
Okay, here we
go. Is that Steve or me? Oh, I was pointing to, I love that. Oh, Dr. Vanessa, she's so cool. I love her, love her, love her. And she let us do our thing. She never like jumped in.
Hold on a
like,
second, Sandy, hold on. Yeah, because I couldn't hear what you were saying, so.
Oh, okay, I did, thought it was a picture. It's funny, you know, I guess over the years of being a mom and stuff, they always said if you want to talk to kids or get them to, you know, understand you, get down on their level, squat down to, you know, be eye to eye with them. And a couple of them would look up at me like, oh, you're, you know, a crazy lady. I don't know what you're talking about. And they had the little hand chart, and I would just get down and say, you know, it's okay. And talk to them in a sweet voice that I don't have all the time. And just explain to them that they had to put their hand a certain way because they were looking at the eye chart. And I watched their faces, because at first it was like, what does she want us to do? And then they got it, and you could see their confidence, and I can see it. I'm gonna do what you asked me to do. And like I said, in the side of the video was Dr. Vanessa. And she just let me, I'm not a doctor or an assistant, but she just let me go with it and interact with the kids. And she never tried to treat me like I didn't know what I was doing. She was so cool. And so watching her with those kids, she was just so making sure that they all got seen, making sure that the one that needed glasses, I watched her with those kids and she was amazing. She was a huge asset to this mission trip. But the kids, like I said, you get down on their level because they're looking at me and it's like, what does she want? Well, then later on, come to find out, somebody asked me and they said, did the kids call you some word? And I'm like, I don't know what you're talking about. And they said, it means white lady. And I'm like, huh? They're like, what? Why would? And then I didn't realize it. Like, you know, I look around and I'm like, oh, okay. I don't know how many white folks they see and it's okay. But I didn't even like, that didn't even go in my mind. And I'm like, okay, maybe they, and then there were kids that they would come up and just touch me and like, okay, cool. I wasn't offended. I just was like, I didn't even think about it. But there was one baby at the hospital that he came up to me and wouldn't let me pick him up. He started crying. Mm. And Dr. Gaboni goes, it's because he doesn't see white people. And I'm like, oh. And I'm like, okay. And then I was like, oh, I'm sad that I scared him. And then I turned around and this other little boy wanted to be picked up. I'm like, okay. And he touched my face and I was like, okay, we're good. That's my buddy. I didn't think about that. I didn't think about being, you know, they're looking at me like, she's telling me what to do. Yeah, it was fun. It was an eye-opening experience. It was something I didn't think about. But they were smart. These kids are smart. And I guess they think like a third world country or children that aren't spoiled to death like us Americanis don't know any, but they're smart. These kids are smart. And I didn't realize that our last day there, they were giving out the awards and the backpacks, the top 5% of those students. So that was cool to watch that little ceremony that they were awarding the children with the academic excellence. Yeah. That was very, very cool. And they were just humble about it. They you didn't see them all strutting around like they were something else. They were just very proud of themselves.
Most of those were the backpacks that Valentine donated, actually.
Oh, okay. With all the extra, yeah, the solid ones, not like the string.
Yeah.
Right, yes.
They were like bright colors, bright solid colors.
Yes, I remember those backpacks well in the storage room there, Perunk.
Yes, I'm sure Valentine remembers that too. Well, we actually took it into so you see, the way we did it when we went that year before, so that dining room where we were eating in the hostel, that would have been our makeshift office space, because we just brought everything down there. Actually, Valentine, we had a spot up on the roof. Year. They had a balcony and we went and worked up on the roof. And
I saw a picture and I said, that was really nice to have. That was a nice view.
I love that hostel. Warm, clean bed and a shower and the little storage space. And then the dining area was cool and the staff was super friendly. But that rooftop view, a couple nights we sneaked up there and just kind of sat and chilled out and looked over the port. It was beautiful. It was amazing. It was at the wind down time. It was really, really nice. It was, I missed the first few nights there. You know, we stayed somewhere else. And that's how I met my good friend, Mike. Mike and I got to be good buddies. And he, I don't know what his last name is. He was taking the pictures and stuff.
Doris.
But
Mike Doris.
Oh my gosh, everybody loved him. So Mike with the Crocs on. He was a cool dude. I think I was his best friend because I had a really great electric converter, the outlet, for the electricity. I don't even know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, the converter.
And he was always, he just looked at me and I'm like, okay, do you have some cough drops? Okay, you can, I would eat his mints and he would use my converter. So it was a really good working relationship. He was a good guy. That's what I said, some of the people that I met, the team was outstanding, outstanding. I just can't say enough about them.
All right, so Sandy, do you have any advice that you would give to anyone who plan on going on our future mission trip?
Absolutely. Big reward at the end of the trip, just spiritually, emotionally, and in the human, the humanity of it. I feel like being older, I had a little more understanding of things about life, but you go in, you don't expect anything. It's an adventure. It's a wonderful adventure. And there's things, of course, when you're in a different country, that you miss. And everyone seemed to miss ice cubes, and it was okay because I knew I'd have to make do without something. I knew I would get on this trip and say, okay, I need some oatmeal. I love oatmeal. But it's something, it is the chance of a lifetime, but I don't look at it that way because I plan on going back. I plan on going back with still my eyes wide open, having a different experience, because now I would be, I want to say, better prepared as far as what I should lug along with me, or what, you know, trying harder to get donations and knowing what needs to be, you know, taken care of. Like Dr. Gaboni had said back on another Zoom meeting, you know, if you can make donations, that's wonderful. And if you do make a cash donation, put it toward what you want. Do you want it toward the hospital needs? Do you want it toward the children's needs? Do you just want it toward the other expenses? But it is definitely a not to be missed opportunity. People should never say shoulda, coulda, woulda. They just need to go for it and walk away. They're going to walk away just fulfilled. And like I told people, I said, my cup runneth over. It was amazing. And I'm this age and I didn't think that something could touch me so deeply. And I was open to anything. And boy, I came away with much more than I ever expected. Much more than I ever expected. And I say, don't miss an opportunity. Go for it. Go for it.
Absolutely. And
don't expect ice cubes.
Thank you.
My pleasure. Somebody.
It's okay.
Oh, girl. So we went, they said, we're going to Zanzibar. And I'm like, we're flying to Zanzibar? What? Wow. So we got over to Zanzibar and we came by the airport and there's a big billboard and it was Freddie Mercury, and I love Queen and I love Freddie. And I was like, oh, that's right. Freddie Mercury's, you know, affiliated with Zanzibar. He was either born here or right, whatever. So I kept saying that, like the kids that I was with younger than me, they're like, hey, it's Freddie Mercury. So I was just super excited. So when we were at the hotel, they're like, oh, we're going to go through the spice market and take a tour. Oh, amazing. That's amazing. Well, then they're like, we're going by Freddie Mercury's house. I was like, yes, Freddie Mercury. So we did go in the Mercury restaurant, the Zanzibar, and I got my Freddie Mercury shirt. And I was like, that was a bonus. Now, mind you, I was there for the mission, but I got the Freddie Mercury experience. I was very happy. So yeah, we got some bonus trips along there with the trip to Zanzibar and the trip to Iringa. Wow. Mm-hmm. Both of those hotels, I was like, oh, why we get to stay somewhere so amazing. For our little, you know, I guess it was a thank you from being mission volunteers, because I'm telling you what, that was amazing. Those two weekends that we were there were amazing. The one in Zanzibar and the one in Iringa, where I was freezing, but it was neat. And the animals we saw on that trip, the to Iringa, and the I'll never forget the mountain pass that we all were sitting on the edge of our seats.
I said I was going to remember the name of that mountain, and I don't even remember it anymore.
I looked it up the other day because I was looking at the map. It was Mahat, M-O-H something. Yeah, see, that's what I mean. My brain can't retain everything. It was so fantastic. But the friend of mine at work, he said, send me some pictures of the highlights of your trip. I was like, oh my gosh, and I just can't even. And he printed me out a collage of pictures at work. Oh my God. He brought it into me, and of course I started crying, and I was looking at every single moment, like you showed me and asked me about my experience. I can give an hour long dialogue about that moment.
That's amazing.
It was amazing. I loved it. I can't wait for next year. So, yes, I'll quit talking now.
Gabon, QHSE.